الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. The book inshallah ta'ala that we're going to start today is called Jilbab al-Mar'a al-Muslimah. This kitab is written by al-Shaykh al-Allama Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani rahimahullah. Al-Shaykh al-Allama Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani. So the scholars, when they start a book, they speak about the book and they also speak about the author of the book. So inshallah ta'ala, many of you probably know of Sheikh Albani. You've read some of his works, but you probably don't know his biography. So inshallah ta'ala, a very abridged biography of the author, rahimahullah, we will do before we start the kitab. Who is the author of this book? His name is al-Shaykh Muhammad Nasiruddin Ibn al-Hajj Nuh al-Albani. The Shaykh, in the Islamic calendar, he was born 1333, which is in accordance to the Muslim, in accordance to the Gregorian calendar. The Shaykh rahimahullah was born 1914. That's World War I. 1914. Shaykh Albani was born World War I. And he was born in a city called Ashqoda. Ashqodra, which is the Asima. It is the capital of Albania. And I don't know if it's the capital now. It used to be the capital when the Sheikh Rahimullah, but I don't know if it's the capital now. I'm not sure. The Sheikh Rahimullah is from a poor family. Sheikh was from a poor family. But there was a family that was in love of knowledge. And you don't really find that common in the Albanian community, that the knowledge and the deen is like that. Sheikh was from a family who loved the ilm and the knowledge and gave importance to it. His father, Sheikh Al-Albani, he was a marji', he was a reference point for the people. He would teach them and he would guide them in their questions and their requests. His father, Sheikh Al-Albani's father, Al-Hajj Nuh, he took his family to Dimashq, Sham, to stay there after the leader of that time, whose name was Ahmed Zaghu, who was the king of Albania, had deviated from the path that the country had, which is some Islamic. It started to adopt more secular approach. His father took him from Albania and he took him to Dimashq Sham. And Sheikh Albani used to always say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with many things. And one of the things Allah has blessed me with, Sheikh Albani used to say, is that my father took me out from Albania and took me to Sham, Dimashq. The Sheikh rahimahullah, he finished his studies, his primary. He finished his primary, dirasatuhu al-itida'iyya, in Madrasat al-Is'af al-Khayri in Dimashq. And his passing rate was bitafawwuq. it was with distinction. The Shaykh passed greatly, and he was sharp as an individual. His father, Shaykh Al-Albani, used to not like this. He didn't like the school system. He wasn't in favor of it. He didn't like it. The dirasat, the madaris al-nizamiyya, these schools and the way they are organized, he didn't like it, the Shaykh. The father of Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. And he didn't like these schools because of the religious angle. The way that the person would lose their deen, and the way it was, he didn't like it. So his father made a decision that he, Albani rahimahullah, will not finish school. He took him out of the school, and he plays for him manhaj al-ilmiyan. His father plays for him a methodology in studying the religion. And Shaykh al-Albani, in that time, he studied the Quran. And his father made him also study tajweed, nahw, and sarf. So Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah, he studied the Quran. He also studied tajweed. And he also studied nahw, grammar. And he also studied sarf, morphology. And he also studied fiqh al-madhab al-hanafi. He studied the madhab, the Hanafi madhab book. He did. And he finished the Quran with his father. And he memorized it bi riwayati Hafsin an Asim. He memorized the common riwayah that we know, the riwayah of Hafs an Asim. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he studied with a Shaykh Sa'id al-Burhani. And he studied with him Maraq al-Falah, which is in a fiqh of Hanafi. He also studied other books of language, Balagha, at that time. And the Shaykh rahimahullah used to give a lot of importance to making sure that he participated in the lessons and also in the seminars and conferences of Allama Bahjat al-Baydar. Shaykh Bahjat al-Baydar, Shaykh al-Albani used to put a lot of effort and hard work in making sure that he participated in the durus and the nadawat, the lessons, and also the conferences and the seminars that were done by Al-Allama Bahjat al-Baytar. Shaykh al-Albani took from his father an occupation which was fixing watches. His father used to fix watches, and that's how he used to bring rizq to his family. And so Shaykh al-Albani, he studied that from his father as well. And he became perfect at it, Shaykh al-Albani. فَأَجَادَهَا, he perfected it until he became what? حَتَّى صَارَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الشُّهْرَةِ فِيهَا. He became very well known for it. People would come to him over everybody else. And that's where he would make his money from. Rahimahullah. And this can show you something, which is that the Shaykh was a daqiq person. Daqiq means what? He would look at minute details. As he would fix watches, would have to really look deep at things. And so Shaykh al-Albani was a person whose character was like that. He was very, very accurate and deep in his personality when he observed things and when he looked at things. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. He, rahimahullah, loved working in this profession. He loved working as a what? And he loved this occupation of fixing watches because it gave him a lot of time. لِلْمُطَالَعَةِ وَالْدِرَاسَةِ. He would go and read. He would have extra time left to go out, to read, to study. And coming to Dimashq benefited the Shaykh for him to study the Arabic language very much. And also to study the ulum of the Sharia from its sources. As I just mentioned, his father pushed Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah to study what? The fiqh of Hanafi madhab. And his father was a muqallid, a blind follower of the madhab al-Hanafi. But his son, Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, he didn't take that methodology like his father. Sheikh al-Albani used to warn excessively from taqleed amat ta'assub al-madhabi, to be fanatic towards madhab. To be a person who is what? Who is muta'assib, who is fanatic when it came to madhab. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he directed himself in studying ilm al-hadith, studying the science of hadith. He studied it, or he started embarking on this, studying ilm al-hadith when he was 20 years of age. And what was it that caused Sheikh al-Albani to go towards hadith? There was a newspaper called Majallatul Manar. It's a magazine, more like. It's called Majallatul Manar. It's a magazine. And this magazine was written by a sheikh called Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida. Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida. Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida, he's the one who wrote this majalla. It was produced. So the Sheikh used to read it. Sheikh al-Albani would read the majalla. And he one day saw on the majalla, Majallatul Manar, he saw on it that Muhammad Rashid Rida referenced Sheikh Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. And as you know, Abu Hamid al-Ghazali is a kitab called what? Ihya Ulumuddin. And Muhammad Rashid Rida, he tackled what you call Abu Hamid al-Ghazali in this issue, authenticating a narration and speaking to him in this regard. So it really fascinated Sheikh Nasir that this was taking place in front of him. He liked what he saw. And the reference that Muhammad Rashid Rida was using to correct Abu Hamid al-Ghazali was from a book called Al-Mughni an Haml al-Asfar fi Taqrij ma fi al-Ihya' min al-Akhbar, written by Al-Imam al-Hafidh Zainuddin al-Iraqi, the Sheikh of Hafidh al-Hajar. Iraqi has a Taqrij on Kitab Ihya' Ulumuddin. So Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida was using the works and the efforts of Iraqi, who's a great scholar of hadith, and he's a teacher of who? He's a teacher of who? Ibn Hajar. So Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, when he saw this, he became happy and pleased. And at that time, the first book that Sheikh Nasir started to do takhrij from, or work on, or even to direct his efforts towards in takhrij, was that kitab. This was his first kitab in which Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, he put his pen and paper on and started to write on the sides. Okay? And Sheikh Nasir, as he said, this majalla, Majallatul Manar by Muhammad Rashid Rida, he said, was a good opening for me. It was Fatihatu Khairin. It opened good doors for me, rahimahullah, until it became Sheikh Nasir, rahimahullah, al-ihtimam, high consideration to hadith and its sciences. And he became very well known in Dimashq for this now. He became very well known for hadith, authenticating narrations, looking at works. He became very well known. Until, rahimahullah, he used to come to his shop every day. He would fix people's watches. He would make his daily income. He would buy food from some of the money that he had. And the Sheikh, rahimahullah, would go directly to a big maktaba called in Damascus, called Maktabat al-Zahiriya. Maktabat al-Zahiriya is one of the biggest Islamic makatib, one of the biggest Islamic libraries. And the Sheikh rahimahullah, the workers in Maktabat al-Zahiriya, when they saw him coming back, coming and leaving at night, they made him a copy of the maktaba. Gave him a copy, and they also even gave him a room. So this is your room. No one else owns it with you except you. Nobody owns it except this. This is only for you. So the Sheikh used to sit there, and he would read every single book that he could find in the maktaba. He would read in that maktaba books that were published and even books that were manuscripts. Books that were what? Manuscripts that have yet not been, they have not been published yet. They have not gone, it's handwritten. It takes hours for you to just understand what a sentence is. Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, he would read those manuscripts. He would go through them and he would work on them. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. As for the first book that he authored himself, that was his works, not a book that he worked on. The first book that he authored from his own efforts and his own work is the Kitab Tahdhir al-Sajid min ittikhadh al-qubur masajid, where he speaks about placing a grave inside a masjid. It's a book which is matbu', is published, many times it got published. Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, his direction towards hadith was different from many people. You might look and say to themselves, well, they know hadith as well. And this is the difference between him and many. Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah was a man who you could say he was a person of hadith and sunnah, both of them. Many people you can say he's a man of hadith. He busies himself in the science of hadith. But Sheikh Nasir was what? A person of hadith and sunnah. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'a. Sheikh al-Albani, through his works, his knowledge of hadith, he used it to propagate and call to tawheed and sunnah in Syria. That the scholars and the people or the students of knowledge in Dimashq would come to Sheikh Nasir and they would argue with him and they would debate with him and they would have munaqashat on masail pertaining to tawheed and masail and niqashat, discussions pertaining to following the sunnah, blind following, bid'ah. People would visit him and they accused him of, after not being able to discuss things with him, not being able to refute his points, they referred to him as a Wahhabi Yundal, a Wahhabi, misguided individual. They would tell the people not to go to him. When at that particular time, many other noble mashayikh and ulama had respected him. They admired his works when they saw what he came out with, such as Al-Allama Bahjat al-Baytar. He saw Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah's efforts. Al-Sheikh Abdul Fattah al-Imam, who was al-Ra'is Jam'iyyat al-Shabban al-Muslimin fi Syria. Al-Sheikh Tawfiq al-Bazara. And other than them, who Ahlul Fadl wa Salah, rahimahumullah, they saw Sheikh Nasir's efforts. And they praised him for his hard work. Bidhalika, if you today sit down and you listen to Sheikh Al-Bani, his debates, you would be amazed of how powerful and eloquent he was in his arguments and how he was able to portray his points. The person would be so much issues forward, he would listen. And what amazed me by Sheikh Nasir was his etiquette of how he dealt with everybody. He would be quiet. Sometimes you would ask yourself, is he even in the room in the debate? Because it's a tape you're listening to, or it's a recording. Sheikh Nasir hasn't got videos. So you're listening. Your question is he in the room? The person might be speaking for 45 minutes, half an hour, and Sheikh Nasir is quiet. But when he takes over, the way he governs everything, the way he controls the debate and the way it's going, his effort and his ability to convince you, and how calm he is. Calm. It's easy the way he's talking. Being that man of knowledge, Sheikh Al-Albani's speech is the most easiest when it comes to listening to it. Of course, he sometimes speaks lahja shabiya. He speaks in the dialect of Sham, but his language is very easy, the way he talks. You would think he's a technical person, the way he would speak, because he's in a technical science. But it's a very simple person. His ayat are to the point, the way he's using the ayat is to the point. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Sheikh Albani's effort in da'wah. Sheikh Nasir rahimahullahu ta'ala, his efforts in da'wah were very strong. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. The Sheikh rahimahullah, his da'wah was fruitful in the following. Number one, his daily lessons that he would give. He would have two lessons a week. The students would come, and even some of the teachers of the universities would come. And the books that he would teach in some of these circles were Fath al-Majid, the Kitab Fath al-Majid, which is the Sharah of Kitab al-Tawheed. He would also teach the book Ar-Rawdat al-Nadiyah, which is the Sharah of Durar al-Bahiyah by Shawkani, and the Sharah of Siddiq Hassan Khan. He would also teach Usul al-Fiqh, the Kitab written by Abdul Wahab Khalaf. He would also teach Al-Ba'ith al-Hathith, Sharh Iqtisar Ulum al-Hadith by Ibn Kathir, and the Ta'liqat. The Iqtisar Ulum al-Hadith is by Ibn Kathir. The Ba'ith al-Hathith is by Ahmed Shakir. He will also teach the Kitab Fiqh al-Sunnah by Sayyid Sabiq and many other things. The second thing that showed that Sheikh's efforts in da'wah was he's traveling. The Sheikh rahimahullah, he used to travel. And he would go to different cities in Syria. He would travel around Syria. He wouldn't just stay in one place. Rahimahullah ta'ala. He would also go to Jordan. And this is before he resided in Jordan. Rahimahullah. And the Sheikh rahimahullah, he also traveled to Western countries. Sheikh Nasir came to the UK. Came and visited the UK. And he did talks and lessons. Sheikh Nasir showed a lot of patience on the harm that he was afflicted with. When it was the year 1960, the Sheikh rahimahullah, he fell under the oppression of the Syrian government, and they arrested him. And the Sheikh was the furthest from politics. He really didn't engage in politics and he didn't involve himself into politics. And the Sheikh got arrested twice. The first time that he got arrested, rahimahullah, he was arrested for 1 month. And he was arrested in Qal'at Dimashq, the fortresses of Dimashq. And he got arrested in the same place that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah got arrested. This place that Shaykh al-Albani got arrested was exactly the same place in which Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah got arrested. Rahmatan wasi'ah. The time that Shaykh Nasir spent in prison for that 1 month, he used to give da'wah in prison. He used to give da'wah to the prison guards. He would give da'wah to the inmates in the prison. He would call them to the sunnah. To the extent that the Shaykh rahimahullah, he had an effect in the prison more than he had in the outer world. He would speak to them about Islamic symbols, the sha'air and the religion, holding on to the sunnah, tawheed and aqeedah, the Shaykh rahimahullah would. The second time the Shaykh rahimahullah, so that first time when he got arrested and the government saw the need to release some of the prisoners, they released him rahimahullah. And then after a period of time, they called him back in again. And this time they arrested him for 8 months. And he stayed in prison. the second time for 8 months. But it wasn't in the Qal'atu Dimashq. This time they didn't take him there. They took him to another prison. Rahimahullah. He stayed there for 8 months. And what he did in those 8 months was, he worked on the Kitab Mukhtasar Sahih Muslim. He requested if that book could be brought to him, and a pen, and papers. And he started to note down points on the book and things of it, and he started to work on it. You can take the believer away from everything else, but knowledge for him is what? It's like oxygen. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he worked on it. Rahmatan wasi'a. Shaykh Nasir, the reason why he was able to achieve that, even in prison, was that he was a very sincere person, Shaykh Nasir. Sincerity level was very high. One of the most famous statements that he used to say a lot is, حُبُّ الظُّهُورِ يُقْسِبُ الظُّهُورِ. He used to say, loving to be out in the open and expose yourself to the people will break your back. حُبُّ الظُّهُورِ, loving to come out and show off, يُقْسِمُ الظُّهُورِ, will break your back. وَلِذَلِكَ A man one time invited the Shaykh rahimahullah, Shaykh al-Bani, invited him over and he said to him, Shaykh, I want you to come and visit my house. And then what happened was, when he invited the Shaykh and told the Shaykh, please come to me, he also announced it on social television. He announced it and told the people, Shaykh Nasir is coming to my house. Al-Bani is going to visit my house. He said it to people. So many people in number came to see the Shaykh, to listen to him. When the Shaykh found out, he refused to go. And so people asked him, Shaykh, why have you refused to go? And he said, حُبُّ الظُّهُورِ يُقْسِمُ الظُّهُورِ. Loving to bring yourself out and to be the forefront will break your back. So one needs to ask himself today, sincerity and loving to bring yourself out and to be the, whenever something is done, instead of just choosing to be maybe at the back of things, to just love to be at the front, it really goes against the secret of success. The Shaykh was also, one of the things that he was very good at is his amanah fil istishara. If somebody told him something, he would keep that for them. Even if whatever happened between them later, the Shaykh will never tell anyone about it. Sometimes some people, they have a secret of you, yours, and they would use it in their advantage. And they would use it against you. One of his students one day, he wanted to sell some of his books due to financial reasons. So he told the Shaykh, he said, Shaykh, do you think I should sell some of my books to get some financial aid and support from it? Or do you believe I should be patient? And what do you think? The Shaykh rahimahullah, he said, don't sell your books. And be patient. Student said, Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. Student left the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, and then the Shaykh sent to the man that asked him, he said, inform him not to sell your maktaba, don't sell any books or any of your stuff, and inshaAllah ta'ala, I will give you what you need financially. I'll give you the money that you need. I will borrow you it until you're able to give it to me. Not when I want it, but until you can give it to me. So this was, if he was consulted and somebody told him something, he would give them the best choice that he thought was the best. And you have to remember, he, rahimahullah, was financially not well off. He reached a level that Sheikh Albani never used to have paper to write on and pen. إلى هذا الحد من الفقر. That he would sometimes write on, if anybody, you know, the post letters that would come to him, he would use that as a, he would not throw them away. Those papers that came to him, he would use those papers to benefit from it as paper and to write on the takhrij of the hadith on it. Some of his takhrij and some of his authentication of the hadith were written on some post papers because of the fact that the Shaykh didn't have money. One of the things that Shaykh Nasir was very unique in was al-diqqatu fil mawa'id. Allahu Akbar. He was precise when it came to promises. He gave you his word and he told you something was going to happen. He was daqiq on that. Al-diqqatu fil mawa'id. Promises that he gave done and he gave were precise. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. The example for this is that he was one time invited by one of his students. One of his students, he called the Shaykh, rahimahullah, to come over and to eat at his house. And he said to him, I want you to come to my place at 1 o'clock. So the Shaykh, rahimahullah ta'ala, he came. And when he came 15 minutes early. And the Shaykh, he stayed in his car. He did not come out. And when it became 1 o'clock sharp, he came and he knocked the door. The Shaykh didn't speak about the issue, and the student, some of the students who were with the Shaykh, who were with him, had informed the one who invited the Shaykh that the Shaykh was 15 minutes outside and he never came and knocked the door. So he went to the Shaykh and he said, why didn't you come and knock the door? And then he said to him, because before the time is as bad as after the time. To come early is as bad as to come after. The reason is because you're busy preparing yourself. You're busy preparing yourself. You're also busy in organizing for the guest. He was like that, rahimahullah. He was also well known for his al-hirsu ala al-awqati wa ightinamiha. The Shaykh used to benefit from his time. He would not let his time go by without a purpose and a goal behind it. Not even a split second. Shaykh Nasir had, one of the things that he was well known for is his time. ولذلك his students, if they came in and the Shaykh rahimahullah, he was in his maktab, Shaykh used to wear glasses. He would carry on reading. And he would carry on reading. He would look at the person from underneath his eyes, underneath his glasses. So he would look at them like this. He says, is there any questions that you have? The person says, yes, I have questions. He says, hey, ask. Once he finishes the question, if Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah put his head down to his book, it meant the time is over. The time is over, you now can go. Sometimes he would say it to the person if he didn't understand, he would say, insarifu, now you can go, inshallah. And if it was from his closest students, he would what? If it was from his closest students, he would rahimahullah ta'ala, they would know that. And if he put his head back to the book, it was a very polite way of him saying to them, it's time for you to go. If the Shaykh rahimahullah was driving from a destination to another place and somebody was with him, he would not let them just spend the time speaking. He would say, if any one of you has a question, let's ask. You can ask. Benefit from this opportunity. And he would teach his students to value every minute of making it a moment of benefit for themselves. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he was al-amalu bil-ilm, implementation of the knowledge. He wasn't a person who took all of those ahadiths without implementing them. He was very well known for his implementation of the knowledge. Shaykh Nasir, as you all know, he passed 80 years of age. He passed 80. He died at 84, 85, whatever. But the Shaykh Rahimullah will still fast. He will start fast Mondays and Thursdays. And the Shaykh Rahimullah, some of the students, they said that we were shab, we were young youths, and we wouldn't fast, some of us. And the Shaykh would say to them, I am fasting, and I'm older than you, I'm 80, you guys are young, he would say to them. And one of the things that he said to them one time was, أخذت على نفسي, I have made a covenant with myself, a promise. أَلَّا أُخَالِفَ بِفِعْلِي قَوْلِي, that my speech does not oppose my actions. And he said, وَاسْتَفَدْتُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ قَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ اللَّهِ شُعَيْبِ. And he said, I benefited this from Nabi Allah Shu'aib. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ إِلَى مَا أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ. I do not want to oppose you. I mean, I do not want to oppose what I prohibit from you guys. I do not want to tell you guys to leave off something, and then I come and then I do it. The Shaykh Rahimahullah, he never ever taught his students a sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, except that he what? Except that he would do it. He would call them to something and he was the first who would do it. To the extent one day the Shaykh was given a lesson and a police officer came in. And the police officer wanted to pray the salah without a sutra. And so the Shaykh said, Ya Shurtiyu, O police officer, istatir, place a sutra. Place a sutra. So the police officer, he went forward and placed a sutra. And when he finished the prayer, he came to the Shaykh and he said to him, Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah reward you for what you have brought to my attention. That's what type of person he was. He also had as a character, al-hikmatu fi nasiha. He was very wise in how he would give the advice and how he would speak to the people. Even though he get the point across, Sheikh Nasir, but he was wise in how he dealt with matters. And he would place people in their places. كَانَ يُنزِلُ النَّاسَ مَنَازِلَهُمْ. And place the people in their positions Allah placed in them. One time his student Aba Islam, who died recently, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, he mentions that, he said that Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah ta'ala, one day he said he came to one of my khutbas. And he said, I didn't know he was there. I used to do khutbas. And Sheikh Nasir was there in the crowd. He would listen to the khutbah. He said, I didn't know he was in the crowd. I wasn't aware of it. And he said, on the pulpit, by accident, slip of a tongue, I mentioned a narration which was weak. And then he said, when the prayer finished, I was shocked that Sheikh Al-Bani was there. And he said to me, Ya Aba Islam, Abu Islam, come and visit me, inshallah, in my house. So I said, I came and I visited him and I sat in his house. And other students were there as well. They were asking him questions and they were speaking to him. And he was responding to them. And then he said to me, Aba Islam, ذَكَرْتَ جُمْلَةَ كَذَا وَكَذَا. You mentioned this in your khutbah. وَأَنَا لَا أَعْلَمُ عَلَيْهَا دَلِيلًا. I have no evidence for that personally, me, Sheikh Albani. فَهَلَّا أَعْلَمْتَنَا. Why don't you teach us, educate us? Ya Aba Islami bi bidaliliha. Why don't you educate us and teach us this evidence? لِنَسْتَفِيدَ مِنْكَ, so we can benefit from you. Allahu Akbar. That's what he said to him. عَلَيْهِ رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ. Why don't you give us the evidence for it so we can benefit from you? Wallahi, that's something one person should look at and observe. And to be honest, this kind of statement right now may not feel big to some of you guys, but I remember one time I quoted a reference and I attributed it by accident to Al-Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. And the statement was said by who? Ibn Al-Qayyim. And I remember my teacher, when I was telling him that, he said, He said to me, I might be wrong, he said. Or he said, I think it might be Ibn al-Qayyim. Was it that way he said it? The way he said it was really, really, it made me think, yeah, it was Ibn al-Qayyim. I knew it was Ibn al-Qayyim. As soon as he said it, I was like, yeah, you're right. Remembered, it is him. But he told it to me in a way where he didn't. It wasn't muwajah. I didn't feel like he came directly at me. He didn't also, I didn't feel like he was correcting me. Are you with me? It was so humble, it was so easy, it was smooth, that I was like, yeah, you're right, Sheikh, I'm wrong. I accepted it. And that's hikmah. Im nasiha, correcting a person in a matter. So when the Sheikh said that to him, the student said to him, ya Shaykhana, Sheikh, inna sabqul lisan. What I said on the pulpit was the slip of the tongue. I also don't have evidence for it. Look what the Sheikh said. Jazakallahu khayran. Arahtana. Jazakallahu khayran. You brought us comfort and relaxation. Wa qassarta alayna al-tariq. And you made the road shorter for us. Other people, they waste your time and they say, yeah, they'll find something for it. I'll research, inshallah. I'll get back to you on this. I know there's something out there. And then you're mu'allaqah. Sheikh Nasir, he just said, mashallah, you made it easy for us. That this, it doesn't exist. Another example that Sheikh Nasir had was one time, one of his students, he said, Sheikh Albani rahimahullah called my house. And he said, I wasn't there. He said, my young daughter picked up. And when she picked up the phone, she said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So the Sheikh asked her, he said to her, is your father home? And she said to him, no, Sheikh. He said, no. He said to her, to the daughter, tell your father that Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani called. He didn't say Sheikh. He didn't say Allama. He called himself Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani. That's who called. Then, when the student came home and he was informed that Sheikh Albani called him, this is Sheikh Albani, so the student straight away called Sheikh Nasir. And he said, Sheikh, may Allah bless you, I heard you called me. The Sheikh said to him, after they talked about what they wanted to talk about, this is showing you daqiq how Sheikh Nasir was. He said, your daughter, when she picked up the phone, and I picked up the phone. She responded. She's the one who picked up the phone. And she said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. He said, is this something she's doing based on knowledge that you taught her? Or is she doing it because she's a young girl? It's a mistake that she came with. Why is it Sheikh Nasir picking up that on that? Because the salam is not for the person who's picking up. It's wrong. When somebody calls you, you do not say Assalamu alaikum. You pick your phone up by saying what? Naam. Yes. They have knocked on your door. They are the ones who came. They are the ones who have to say Assalamu alaikum. Are you with me? That's the sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? Somebody comes to your house, you open the door, you say Naam. They say Assalamu alaikum. Because the ayah says, وَإِذَا دَخَلْتُمْ بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتِكُمْ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَى أَهْلِهَا. You take permission and you greet the people at the house. Are you with me? So when you pick up the phone, what do you say? Naam. Are you with me? The person would say what to you? Salaam alaikum. And then what do you say? Wa alaikum as-salam. Are you with me? So he picked up on that. رَحِمَهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً. That's to show you that he was not just a scholar alone. He was a murabbi. He was a nurturer. He was a cultivator. He cultivated the community he was from. He taught the people around him. He called them to the smallest of the sunnah. He didn't take anything insignificant. One of the things that Sheikh Nasir was he also had is al-thabatu ala al-manhaj. Sheikh Nasir was firm, steadfast, upright on the correct methodology. He always used to say, عَلَيْكُمْ بِالثَّبَاتِ عَلَى التَّوْحِيدِ. Be steadfast upon Tawheed. Hold on to the Sunnah. Hold and tread on the path of the methodology and the path and the way of the companions. Ridwanullahi alayhi wa jalla. He used to repeat that many times. If you listen to his tapes, he always talks about that. And he always says the ayah, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. And he would recite the ayah, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. And he would always read the hadith, سَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي عَلَى 73 فِرْقَةٍ كُلُّهُمْ فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٍ. The Sahabas, they said, who's that saved group that's going to make it to Jannah when all the other groups are going to go to the hellfire? The Prophet said, مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمَ وَأَصْحَابِي. Anyone who is upon that which I and my companions are upon, that's the only people who are going to go to paradise. That's the people who are going to make it to paradise straight away. So Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah used to repeat this hadith a lot. He used to always say, أَدْعِيَاءُ الْمَنْهَجِ كَثِيرٌ. The claimers of correct methodology are many. Many claim it. وَالَّذِينَ يَثْبُتُونَ عَلَيْهِ قَلِيلٌ. But those who are firm upon it are little. And he said, وَسَتَعْرِفُ ذَلِكَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِي. And you all will know that after my death. How many people? Wallahi, it's so true. Sometimes he used to say, رحمه ta'ala, he used to say, ليلة الظلماء يفتقد البدر. He used to say, the dark night, people will know the value of the moon. The people will know the value of what they have when the moon goes. He used to always say as well, المعاصرة حرمان. When you're with a people, it prevents them from seeing your value. You find the quality of something when you lose it. You realize what this person was doing for you and what they were holding from you. Rahimahullah. He used to say that. And when he died, it was true. Many people became clear to the people. They used to claim the love of the Shaykh. They used to claim that they were of his methodology. They used to deceive the people by rubbing on the Shaykh. You know, the Shaykh knows me and whatnot. But when the Shaykh, rahimahullah, died, and they knew they couldn't speak when the Shaykh was alive. They knew they couldn't respond to him. Because the Shaykh had the pen and the paper. And he had the knowledge. They were scared of him. But as soon as he died, they started to accuse him of irja. They started to accuse him of what they could accuse him of. Rahimahullahu ta'ala, rahmatan wasi'ah. The Shaykh was very, very humble. And he used to teach his students to be humble. And one of the good examples of his humbleness and his was, he would sometimes go and visit after Salatul Fajr. He would go and visit. Are you with me? He would sometimes go to his students and he would visit them after Fajr. And he would buy gifts on the way. And he would go to give, and he would knock on their houses and he would give it to them. And he would say to them, هذه هدية. This is a gift. لا يقدمها لك إلا الألباني. No one else is going to give you this gift except Sheikh Albani. No one else is going to give you this gift except Albani. He would say that to them. Rahimahullah, this is his tawadu' and his humility. Meaning, he's saying that this cheap gift, no one else is going to give it to you except Albani. This simple stuff, only Albani is going to give it to you. He sometimes, if he saw his students in his gathering, and he saw that their facial expression wasn't good, and they felt a bit sad and depressed or pain, the Shaykh rahimahullah, from his busy time, he would call them, if that was what he was able to do, to bring comfort to their heart, and to say to them, don't worry, inshallah ta'ala. And he would give them words of comfort. The Shaykh was very, very patient in da'wah. Very, very patient. Whenever he would be told about somebody who would wrong him, or he would be told, مثلا, that he, a calamity or something had been befallen him, the Shaykh would consistently and continuously say, حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي مَظْلُومٌ فَانْتَصِرْ. Oh Allah, I am oppressed, give me victory. He would say that, rahimahullah ta'ala. Shaykh al-Bani was, without a doubt, he was a mountain. He was a shade for many. Many would shade him. And he was a mountain that nothing could move him. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. No government backed him. And no one financed him, gave him money. He was a one man. But he himself alone was a government. He himself alone was a leader. Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah ta'ala, the scholars, they praised him. Shaykh Ibn Baz said, Ma ra'aytu tahta adim al-sama, I never saw anyone under the sky, a'aliman bil hadithi, who is knowledgeable in hadith, in this era, at this time, مثل العلامة محمد ناصر الدين الألباني, like Albani. I don't know anyone under the sky who is more knowledgeable in hadith than Albani rahimahullah. One time Shaykh Ibn Baz was asked about the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إن الله يبعث لهذه الأمة, Allah will bring out for this ummah, على رأس كل مئة سنة, every 100 years Allah will bring a person who will revive the religion for the people. Who is this person? Al-Bani Ibn Baz was asked. And he said, Al-Shaykh Muhammad Nasiruddin Al-Albani. He is the one Allah brought out for this ummah to revive it. Huwa mujaddidu hadha al-asri fi dhanni. In my belief, he is the reviver of this time. Ibn Baz said this. Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad, he said, Al-Bani rahimahullah is min al-ulama al-afdhal. He's from the elite scholars. Alladhina afnaw a'marahum fi khidmati as-sunnah wa at-ta'lifi fiha, who spent all of his life in the working in the sunnah and working and authoring in this regard, calling to the path of Allah, giving victory to the aqidah as-salafiyya, fighting against innovation, defending the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, وَهُوَ مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ الْمُتَمَيِّزِينَ. He is from the unique, noble scholars. And he said, his nobility has become famous amongst the general and the specific. And then he said, وَلَا شَكَّ, without a doubt, أَنَّ فَقْدَ مِثْلَ هَذَا الْعَالِمِ, without a doubt, the losing of this individual, Shaykh al-Bani. Because this is what this statement Abdul Muhsin Abbad was saying when Albani died. He said, losing this scholar is from the Masa'ib al-Kibar, is from the great calamities that has been fallen on this ummah. And he said, فَجَزَأْهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا, may Allah reward him with good, عَلَى مَا قَدَّمَ, in that which he has put forward, in the efforts that he has done. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen said about him, فَالَّذِي عَرَفْتُهُ, that which I know of him, Shaykh Albani, من خلال اجتماعي به, when I met him, وهو قليل, it was little that I met him. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen said, I never met him much. But the little time, I heard they met each other only twice. But he said, those little times that they met, he said, إنه حريص جدا على عمل بالسنة. This is what he said to him. The little that I met him, I came to know that he's an individual who strives hard to follow the Sunnah. ومحاربة البدعة, to fight innovation, سواء كان في العقيدة, whether it be matters of عقيدة, أم في العمل, or whether it be matters of fiqh. He said, that's in terms of my meeting him. When I saw that, that's what I felt from him. He said, أما من خلال قراءتي لمؤلفاتي, but he said, when I read his works, his books, فقد عرفت عنه ذلك, I came to realize what I saw from him in his works as well. وأنه ذو علم جم, he's a man of great knowledge in hadith. And then look what he said, riwayatan wa dirayatan, his knowledge of hadith is in terms of narration and the fiqh of the hadith. Allahu Akbar. he said that. Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى قَدْ نَفَعَ فِي مَا كَتَبَهُ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ. And that which he has written, Allah has benefited many people with it. In terms of knowledge. مِنْ حَيْثُ الْعِلْمِ وَمِنْ حَيْثُ الْمِنْهَاجِ. And in terms of methodology. رحمه الله تعالى. Shaykh Albani رحمه الله, before he died, رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً, he gave an advice, a farewell. And this is exactly what he said. He said, I advise my wife and my children and my friends and everybody who loves me, if my death reaches them, that they make for me, أَنْ يَدْعُوَ لِي بِالْمَغْفِرَةِ وَالرَّحْمَةِ, that they ask for me forgiveness and mercy, first of all. And he said, وَأَلَّا يَبْكُوا, and that they don't cry. In what? لَكِنْ عَلَى نِيَاحَةٍ أَوْ بِصَوْتٍ مُرْتَفِعٍ. They don't wail, basically. They don't scream about my death. This is to my wife. This is to my children. This is to my friends. This is also to those who love me. Don't scream when you hear of my death. He said, that's the first thing. The second wasiyah that I'm writing is, أَنْ يُعَجِّلُوا, that they hasten my burial. And he said not to inform my family members and my brothers, except if there is a need for them to partake in my burial. There's a need for them to come and do something. But if there's no need, don't waste time informing them. Hasten my burial to take me fast to my grave. And he said, I specifically want my washing to be done by Izzat, he said. Khadir Abu Abdullah, he should do it. He's my neighbor and my friend who is sincere. And anyone who he chooses to bury, to wash me, he can use. It's up to him. Number three, I want to be buried in the closest place. Why? لِكَيْ لَا يَضُرَّ مَنْ يَحْمِلُ جَنَازَتِي. So the person who's carrying my body, I'm not too heavy and I don't cause them hardship. And the reason why Sheikh Nasir said that he didn't want him to be placed inside a car. He wanted to avoid that. He wanted the sunnah to be followed. If they can take him to the closest, he mentions that. And he said, if it could be in the Maqbara al-Qadima, which was the closest, from the closest ones, he mentioned that one specifically because it was the one burial that there was a high speculation that the people who are in it would not be brought out. All the other burials were being changed and being used for something else. He said, don't tell anyone outside the country when I die, from my children, let alone anyone else, except after I'm being taken to my grave or I'm being taken to my burial. The reason why is that this does not stir the people's emotions and it plays its role in wrongdoings, and that they oppose the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, that I meet him and that he has forgiven me for my sins, that which has passed and that which is to come. And he said, as for my library that I left behind, سَوَاءً مَا كَانَ مِنْهَا مَطْبُوعًا, any books that are written which are published, أو مَخْطُوطًا, or anything that are still manuscripts, I haven't finished working, because he was still writing, all of it is a gift to the University of Medina, لِأَنَّ لِي فِيهِ ذِكْرَيَاتْ حَسَنًا. He says, because I have good memories of Medina when I used to be there. في الدعوة للكتاب والسنة, when I used to call to the Kitab and the Sunnah over there. وعلى منهج السلف الصالح, and I used to call to the methodology of the pious predecessors. يوم كنت مدرسا فيها, the days I used to be a teacher in the university. I hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, أَن يَفْعَ بِهَا رُوَادَهَا. I ask Allah, he benefits He said, I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he benefits the students who come to the jami'ah to benefit from my works, as he had benefited them from the days I used to be with them when I used to teach them. Then he concluded with the ayah, Rabbi, أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي وأن أعمل صالحا ترضاه وأصلح لي في ذريتي إني تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين. Sheikh Nasir, he died on a Saturday when it was الثاني والعشرون من جماد الآخر. The year was 1420. It was in accordance to the Islamic, the Gregorian calendar, 1999. And he was buried after Salat al-Isha. And the Shaykh's burial was done as he requested. It was hastened and it was made fast for two reasons. The first reason was, تَنْفِيدُ وَصِيَّتِي كَمَا أَمَرَ. He requested for this. He asked his students and those around him to hasten his burial, so they followed his advice. And the second reason was because those days, it was extremely hot. So when he died on Isha, they didn't make it reach the daytime, because if it did, people would burn and the heat would kill the people. And even though many people were not told about it, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, his burial was still large in number. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he resurrects Shaykh Nasir with the people who his works, their works, he made sure that he worked for. In other words, the Prophet's Sunnah and the Ulama. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen was called after Sheikh Albani died. They informed him, they said, Sheikh, Rahimahullah, Sheikh Albani died, and this is his wasiyah. They read it on Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, that was advice. And Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen said something very powerful. He said, Sheikh Nasir, he did the Sunnah when he was alive. He followed the Sunnah so much even when he was alive. And now that he died, he made sure that the Sunnah was also followed in the way he gets buried. And as you all know, Sheikh Nasir had a book written on how to the janazah of a Muslim. And made sure he followed each and every one of that. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to conclude there bi'idhnillah for today. And inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow we're going to start the kitab. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.